Okay, let's classify the types of intermolecular forces. So we're going to define intermolecular forces here as non-covalent and non-ionic interactions that add up to govern many properties of matter, including boiling point and vapor pressure, melting point, surface tension, adhesion, and cohesion. So if you had something where the adhesive forces to a graduated cylinder were stronger than the cohesive forces, then what you're going to have is a meniscus that sticks to the wall, so adhesion wins. And in that same thought, if you had cohesive forces that are stronger than adhesion, you're going to have a meniscus that does like this. So like mercury versus water, mercury is going to bend up, its cohesion stronger than adhesion, water would have a dip down because it has adhesion stronger than cohesion. And we always measure from the top or bottom of the meniscus on a graduated cylinder. Viscosity, the resistance, the flow, all these properties are governed by the intermolecular forces and non-covalent interactions. And so let's talk about the types. Dipole-dipole is our first type here. It requires two permanent dipoles. So we need differing electronegativity between two atoms, two polar molecules. So for example, if we have HCl in the gas phase, not to be confused with HCl aqueous, which is an acid, hydrochloric acid is HCl aqueous, we're talking about hydrogen chloride gas. So this is a molecular compound. Well, if we look at the bond, chlorine is more electronegative than hydrogen, so it's going to hog more than its fair share of electrons. Okay, and so it's more exaggerated even than I'd, so let's try there, more than its fair share of electrons on one side of the molecule. And so what that does is it forms a partial negative charge to one side and a partial positive charge to the other. This is lowercase delta, and it just means partial. Okay, so a partial positive, partial negative. That's a dipole. Whenever you have two atoms of differing electronegativity increases as you move up. Here's my crude periodic table here. Up and to the right of the periodic table towards fluorine, we increase in electronegativity. Okay, so chlorine's more electronegative than hydrogen. And so that dipole, that's a covalent bond. That's a polar covalent bond. Okay, but there's an interaction that occurs between two HCls where two dipoles come into play here. The interaction that we get between positive and negatively charged ends of a polar molecule, that's the dipole-dipole IMF, the intermolecular force represented here. It's weaker than a covalent bond, much weaker than a covalent bond, but it's still powerful when it adds up. Hydrogen bonding is a special case of polar covalent bonds where we get a greater electrostatic attraction than you would expect from polarity alone. And so what we have here, if we look at water, oxygen is more electronegative than hydrogen, so we're going to develop polarity here. And the OH, NH, and FH bonds exhibit this behavior. And so both of these bonds would be a hydrogen bond potential candidate. And so what happens is you arrange these atoms and molecules where their minus charges near up to their positive counterparts in the polar molecules, and you get these interactions. So I could even draw one more here where we have a hydrogen delta plus talking to the delta minus of our oxygen atom. And so those non-covalent interactions, they're not full bonds. I'm just showing them as partial attractions here, okay, they're really electrostatic attractions, they add up to something very powerful. So I've shown three different hydrogen bond intermolecular force interactions here between hydrogen and oxygen of an OH bond. So you've got a B and OH bond or an NH bond, and then the actual intermolecular force that occurs is between molecules. It's not within the same molecule. The covalent bond OH is not the intermolecular force. It's the partial positive and partial negative charges attracting each other between molecules. A dipole-induced dipole interaction is when you have a permanent dipole, but you induce a charge in a nonpolar molecule or atom. So nonpolar, textbook definition is electronegativity difference. So we'll say electronegativity difference is less than 0.4, less than or equal to 0.4, or less than 0.5, you'll see from some places. CH falls into that category, and anything bonded to itself has an electronegativity difference of zero, so these are considered to be nonpolar. Okay, and anything greater than that 0.5 or 0.4 threshold is considered polar. So if we take our HCl gas molecule and bring it near a nonpolar oxygen molecule, not showing the lone pairs here, but they're there. Don't forget about the lone pairs. This is before. Beforehand, we're going to have a delta plus, a permanent dipole on the polar molecule, and we're going to have no interaction. The electron cloud is perfectly symmetrical on that two oxygens bonded to themselves. That's O2 molecule, okay? And so no charge. We can then induce, this is not a reaction arrow, I'm just saying this is like time. Let's go over time, bring these together, bring the HCl closer to the oxygen molecule, and over time you induce a dipole to occur because of the dipole that you've brought nearby. So what's happened here is you started with an even distribution of the electrons, but because this negative charge is here, you kind of push away the electron density from one side of the oxygen molecule to the other, the nonpolar molecule, and create a delta plus, delta minus that is temporary or induced. Okay, and so we can see the whole thing here, temporary or induced dipole. And so that attraction then occurs, and that is the induced dipole intermolecular force, is the permanent dipole to the induced dipole. A little bit weaker than a dipole-dipole interaction in most cases, okay? And then finally, we have induced dipole, where you have two nonpolar molecules that interact to produce temporary dipoles when they're near each other. These are called dispersion forces, and greater surface area means greater dispersion forces, or induced dipole, so that one gives the other. So if we look at the halogens, fluorine is a gas, it's nonpolar, not very strong IMFs. Chlorine, we would consider to be a gas. Bromine, we consider to be a liquid. But then iodine, we consider to be a solid. Okay, so what makes iodine a solid, bromine a liquid? They're stronger intermolecular forces, because what you're doing, if you're looking at the fluorine to fluorine molecule, every time you go down the periodic table, you're getting bigger and bigger and bigger, so your surface area is increasing. Now, all of these are supposed to be nonpolar, okay? So iodine, two iodines coming together, and I'll go back to a smaller scale for room purposes here. Before they induce dipoles, they're both nonpolar, no charge. This is before they come together. But after two molecules that are nonpolar come together temporarily, they can induce a dipole in one another, where this side's now a little more electrons than it should have, has a little more electron density. This side has a little bit less, this side a little bit more. And so then you get that electrostatic attraction between the two molecules that constitutes the temporary induced dipole interaction. And when your lobes of your molecule are big enough, you're said to be highly polarizable. Okay, so big molecules are and big atoms are highly polarizable, and they're very, they create very strong induced dipole interactions.